Hello, greetings, and welcome. I'm Brien Posey, and in this video, I want to show you something that I've been working on lately, namely splitting PowerShell scripts into smaller pieces. Let me begin by showing you a script that I wrote a few months ago. This particular script was a PowerShell-based editor. I'll go ahead and run the script now. So here you can see my PowerShell-based editor, and you'll notice that we have a menu along the top. If I click on File, we have options for Open, Save, and Exit. Under Edit, we have Undo, Cut, Copy, Paste, and Find. And under Format, we have Font. So if I were to type a bit of text, I could select some of the text and go to Format and change the font. And when I'm done, if I wanted to, I could save this. By default, documents are saved in RTF format, but that's not the only option. If I wanted to, I could save this as a Word document or as a text file. So that's just a really quick overview of what my PowerShell editor does. Now, as you can imagine, it took quite a bit of code to create the script that I just showed you. As a matter of fact, let's take a look at the script's code for just a moment. So here we have the code that was used to create the editor script that I just showed you. And I'm not going to go through all of this other than just to show you that this is a relatively lengthy script. And just out of curiosity, let me go ahead and click on the last line. And when I do, you can see that the script is about 216 lines in length. Now, recently, I created a much more advanced PowerShell script, and that particular script was 820 lines in length. And you can imagine what it was like trying to create and edit 820 lines of code in one big file. The debugging process took forever because I was constantly having to move up and down in the script and locate blocks of code. The length of the script just made it really difficult to find what I was looking for. Sure, I was able to use the find function within my editor in order to make it a little bit easier to find what I was looking for, but the editing process as a whole would have been a whole lot easier if the script was shorter. With that in mind, recently I've been working on a much, much longer script. I'm building a full-blown application, and this application contains dozens of features and lots of moving parts. So one of the things that I've been working on is a method for breaking that particular application into smaller, more manageable pieces. So that way, if I run into a problem debugging the script, it's a whole lot easier to find the section of code that contains the problem. So I've been experimenting with a few different methods. You can use Invoke-Expression to call an external script. Certainly that's an option. You can also create a PowerShell module containing a variety of different functions related to your script. That's another way that you can shorten a script, is by moving functions out into a module. And I've been experimenting with those and with a few other methods. One method that I particularly like, and it seems to be working out really well for my particular use case, is something called dot sourcing. Dot sourcing is really just a method of calling external scripts. So what I've done for the sake of demonstration is I've created a dot sourced version of the script that I just showed you, my PowerShell editor. So once again, this particular editor is 216 lines in length. So let me go ahead and close this out. And I want to switch over to a dot-sourced version of the same editor. So this is the exact same script that I just showed you. The only difference is that I'm using dot-sourcing as a way of making the script modular. So here's what the script looks like now that I've used dot-sourcing. And you can see that this is a whole lot shorter. What you see on the screen is the entire script. So where did the rest of the code go? Well, I stored the rest of the code in modular blocks that are stored outside of the script. So if we take a look at the script that's on screen, we begin by adding the necessary assemblies. From there, I create a form. And when you're building a GUI in PowerShell, a form is really just a window. So we're creating the window that is used by the editor. From there, I create a text box. And the text box is what you saw just a moment ago, where I was able to enter text and then change the format of that text and that sort of thing. And then I've got a line of code that adds that text box to the form. And then I come to this section right here, load the menus using dot sourcing. So the first thing that you'll see in this section is dot space dot slash and then menu.ps1. So menu.ps1 is an external PowerShell script, and I'm loading that PowerShell script and I'm executing it in real time as a part of this script. So let me go ahead and minimize this and let's take a look at menu.ps1. So here we have the menu.ps1 file, and as the name suggests, this is the section of code that creates the menus that are used by the script. So let me go ahead and run the script. If I pull up File Explorer, you'll notice that I've got a script that I ran just a moment ago when I demonstrated my PowerShell editor. But here's the modular editor.ps1 file. This is what we're looking at right now. So let me go ahead and execute this. So as you can see, the script executes in exactly the same way that it did before. So the section of code that we're taking a look at right now creates this menu right here, the file, edit, and format. Now there is another menu that's used by this script, and it's a context menu, or shortcut menu as it's sometimes called. And the way that you access that menu is by right-clicking within the editor. And I've just created a really small shortcut menu. So if I right-click, you can see that we have options for copy and paste. So that's the second menu. For right now, the menu that I'm looking at is right here with file, edit, and format. So with that said, let me go back to the menu.ps1 file that we were looking at just a second ago. So here we are back in menu.ps1, and you can see that the first thing that this particular block of code does is to create a menu strip object. And then from there, we create the object that defines the file menu. Now, after we create the file menu, we need some menu items that can appear on the file menu. And those items are open, save, and exit. But rather than embedding those particular options directly in this file, what I've done instead is I've used dot sourcing once again. So here we have dot sourcing for open.ps1, for save.ps1, and for exit.ps1. So what I've done is I've created a separate file for each one of these menu options. So we have a file for the open option, we have a file for the save option, and we have a file for the exit option. And then if I were to scroll down just a little bit more, we also have dot sourcing for the edit menu. Here we have undo.ps1, cut.ps1, copy.ps1, paste.ps1, and find.ps1. And then finally, we do the same thing for the format menu. So here we're defining the format menu, and then I'm using dot sourcing to load font.ps1 because the font option appears on the format menu. Now, you may be wondering, why am I using dot sourcing in this way? It has to do with the fact that some of these areas of functionality are really big, some are really small. So rather than including all of these different options within the menu code, I thought that it might be easier to just break them out into separate files. So let me show you what I mean. Let me go ahead and minimize this for a second. And let's take a look at an example of a really small menu option. And the smallest one is probably the exit menu option. And so here you can see that we only have two lines of code. So in the first line of code, we create a new object of type system.windows.form.toolstripMenuItem. So this actually creates the menu item, and you can see that the menu item is called exit. And then the next thing that we do is we define a click action. So what happens if somebody clicks on the exit menu item? Well, in this case, the click action is just close the form. Form.close terminates the program. So this is an example of a menu item that didn't require much code at all. And to be perfectly honest with you, if all of my menu items were like this, I wouldn't have even bothered to use dot sourcing. But some of the menu items require a bit more code. As an example, the find menu item contains quite a bit more code. Let's take a look at that for a second. So here's the find menu item. And like before, we begin by creating a toolstrip menu item, and we're calling it find. And then the next thing that we have to do is define a click. But whereas the exit menu item's click action involved a single command, the find menu option's click action involves a lot of commands. So it really made sense to break this one out into a separate file, just as a way of isolating the code related to the find menu item so that we don't have to deal with that in the main body of our script or within the menu itself. So one of the big questions that I'm sure comes to mind is, why might I do something like this as opposed to just exporting all of the various functionality into a PowerShell module? Well, there are a couple of different reasons. One is by doing things this way, you don't have to remember to load a module. Another reason why I chose to do this as opposed to just creating a module is that when you create a module, everything in that module has to be contained in functions. And functions just really didn't feel right for some of what I'm doing. Another advantage to using this method is that you don't have to worry about passing parameters to and from the function. Also, any variables that get defined by any of these code segments that I'm loading through dot sourcing are considered global, so they're valid throughout the entire script, and that just makes the coding process a lot easier because we don't have to worry about localized variables. Now, one question that I do want to address before I wrap up this video is if there are any disadvantages associated with using this particular method. Well, depending on what you're trying to accomplish, the fact that variable assignments are treated as global could be considered to be a disadvantage. To me, the bigger disadvantage is what happens when you try to run something like this. Okay, so here we are in PowerShell, and I'm going to type cd scripts, cd editor, and for anybody who might not be familiar with what I just did, that just takes me to the path where my editor file is stored. And if I type dir, you can see the files that are in this folder. So I'm going to type .slash, and then I'm going to type modular-editor.ps1, and I'll press enter, and I get a security warning. Now, watch what happens when I try to run the script. I'll press R for run. Then I see another security warning. Once again, I have to press R for run. And then this happens yet again, and again, and again, and again. And believe it or not, we're not caught in an infinite loop. What's happening is that I'm having to approve every single file that this particular script is using. And so then finally, my script runs. So that's obviously a little bit annoying. The good news is that there's an easy way to fix this. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to right-click on my main script, and I'm going to go to Properties. So here I am on the General tab, and if you look at the very bottom, we have a Security section. And there's a warning that says this file came from another computer and might be blocked to help protect this computer. So the reason for this is that the computer that I use to develop PowerShell scripts is different from the computer that I use to record videos on. So I wrote this script on a different computer. I copied it to the machine that I'm recording this video on. So because I wrote the script on a different computer, I get the security warning. So the way that you get rid of this is simply by selecting Unblock and clicking OK. So now if I right-click on the modular-editor.ps1 script again and go to Properties, that security warning is gone. So I'm going to go ahead and cancel out of this. And then what I'm going to do is repeat what I just did, but for every one of these files that you see right here. So I'm going to start with copy. I'll right click and go to properties, and then I'll choose unblock and click OK. And I'm going to pause the video for 1 second while I do the rest of these. I'm not going to make you sit through that. And then we'll take a look at what happens when I run the script. Okay, so I've unblocked all of the files and hopefully I haven't missed anything. So let me switch back over to PowerShell and let's try running the script one more time. And this time the script opens right up. So that's how you get rid of all of those security warnings that can occur when you use multiple files like that. I'm Brien Posey. Thanks for watching.